So in this presentation, we're going to look at the requirements for ADS, automatic disconnection of supply. It is not acceptable to have a fault in circuit that remains there for an extended period of time, as there is a rise of risk of electric shock, fire and explosions. In the event of a fault, we expect the circuit with the fault in it to automatically disconnect, leaving all other circuits that are healthy, obviously energized and still working. In order for this to happen, ADS has to be in place. And we're going to look at the requirements for ADS on this rig. This rig is simulating an earthing arrangement, which is TNCS. And we're going to look at the conductors and how they are connected in order to comply with ADS. We will also add in the IP ratings of electrical enclosures and talk about exposed and extraneous parts. In order for ADS to apply, we go and look at the mains end. So we've simulated here our mains end, and we've got our meter towers coming in from our cutout. Our cutout in this case has a 100 amp fuse in it. That could be 60 or 80. So the supply authorities have provided us this time with a 100 amp single phase cutout. The 25 millimeter squared towers are in place. It's a TNCS earthing arrangement. So the towers are 25 millimeter squared coming in from the supply authority. The meter towers coming out from the meter are also 25 millimeter squared, an entire consumed unit. We have the green and yellow conductor from the supply authority. This one here is the earthing conductor, and it is 16 millimeters squared. The 16 millimeter squared earthing conductor goes into, in this case, our main earth terminal, MET. Some installations don't have an MET, and this 16 mil earthing conductor would come from the supply authorities directly into our earth bar. But in this instance, and a lot of awarding bodies such as sitting guilds and EAL would love to have an external MET, main earth terminal. So our 16 mil earthing conductor comes in, it's terminated into our main earthing terminal. We go out into our consumer units again with an earthing conductor, so it's 16 millimeters squared. So this conductor, for all intents and purposes, the same conductor, is an earthing conductor. In this installation from the MET, we've got our protective bonding conductors, which would go off around the installation to connect to gas, water, and oil. In this case, we've simulated the termination at a metallic water pipe and a metallic gas pipe. The protective bonding conductors are 10 millimeters squared in size. As a rule of thumb, in a domestic dwelling, it's unlikely never to be bigger than 10 millimeters squared, and we size it off our incoming tails. But it's worth bearing in mind, if in a domestic dwelling, the gas, water, oil, etc. is more than 27 meters away from the, in this case, main earthing terminal, it needs to be increased in size. Very few domestic dwellings would have a water, gas, or oil pipe greater than 27 meters. Our default position at college is that we have, obviously, 25 millimeter squared meter towers. In a domestic dwelling, our earthing conductor is 16 millimeters squared, and our protective bonding conductor is 10 millimeters squared. As we move into industry and the incoming supply cable is far greater, these conductors increase dramatically in size. This is a 100 amp domestic dwelling that we're simulating. So our conductor sizes are 25, 16 and 10 millimeters squared. The protective bonding conductors in this case, we're simulating going to gas and water, are terminated. It's difficult to see on here, but they have to be terminated with a clamp that says on their safety electrical connection, do not remove. It has to be terminated within 600 millimeters of the incoming point. So in other words, consumer side, so after a water stop tap, after the gas meter, within 600 mil of entering that installation. However, if there is a T-piece, and they call it a branch in the regulations, if there is a T-piece in either gas or water pipe, the clamp must be made before that if it is obviously under 600 mil. So it's within 600 mil or before the first branch in order that we make these two connections. There's oil, obviously, the same principle applies. So our protective bonding conductor in 10 millimeters squared goes off and connects to our gas and water pipes, which are metallic in this case, within 600 mil consumer side in the installation. In the event of there being a fault to the metallic water pipe or metallic gas pipe, we expect the circuit to disconnect. We do not expect the voltage between bonded metalwork to rise above 50 volts AC. We expect automatic disconnection to occur as we rise up to that 50 volt value. 50 volts is the touch voltage AC, the point of which it starts to feel it as a human being, it starts to become uncomfortable. We wouldn't want a voltage to appear in our pipework. So therefore, once we're approaching that value, we expect the circuit to automatically disconnect. What we also wouldn't want to do is if we had adjacent pipe work next to each other, one of them being at 0 volts potential and one of them being at, say, 30 or 40 volts potential. If the pipework was close enough together, what you create is an arc between the two pipeworks. And that arc, if it was coming from the water pipe to the gas pipe, could burn or mark away at the pipe, causing it to eventually to rupture. Obviously, the arc would then create a fire and also an explosion against the gas. So remember, ADS is trying to reduce the risk of three things: shock, fire, and explosions. So we bond our metal pipework in order that we keep it at the same potential. We wouldn't want that potential to rise above 50 volts AC.
But let's clarify that. If this pipe here had a voltage in it, say up to 50 volts, and this pipe here was at 0 volts potential, and they were very close together, there is a great chance that the voltage that appears here in the water pipe would make its way, jump across through an arc onto the gas pipe. Eventually, that arc could burn its way through the copper, and then eventually ignite the gas within it. So therefore, not only when there's a voltage appears in a pipe, there's a risk of electric shock. If we create an arc, the arc can cause a fire. And if the arc goes to something that's highly flammable, such as gas, if it burns its way through, obviously there's a massive risk of explosions. So in order to reduce the risk of shock, fire, and explosions, we must make sure that all bonded metalwork is at the same potential.
In order for ADS to apply, we need the appropriate fuses in the appropriate places. I've already suggested that the fuse here in the incoming cutout is 100 amps. It could be 80 or it could be 60. We've got a 100 amp cutout fuse, 25 mil tails, 16 mil earthing conductor entering our consumer unit. Before entering, I'm to confirm the IP rating. IP stands for Index of Protection or International Protection. Both of those can come up in our exam, both for IP and what it stands for. So we want the IP rating of this electrical enclosure and all electrical enclosures to follow the following rules. The top surface of any electrical enclosure, consuming unit, cooker switch, socket outlet, must be IP4X. In other words, objects exceeding 1 millimeters cannot enter the top of any electrical enclosure. What we're trying to do is prevent dust falling into the top of an electrical enclosure and then building up. So the IP rating at the top of all electrical enclosures must be IP4X. The remainder, so the sides and bottom of an electrical enclosure must be IP2X. Objects exceeding 12 millimeters cannot enter that electrical enclosure. What it's really suggesting for IP2X is that we cannot stick our index finger into the electrical enclosure. It includes the front surface as well. So as we open it up, we can see the blanks are in place, meaning that I cannot push my finger into any part of this electrical enclosure, meaning the front surface also is IP2X. We'll expand this knowledge as we move forward and we'll start calling it IPXXB. We'll distinguish the length of the finger and the width to be 80 mil long and 12 mil wide that can also not enter the electrical enclosure. For the time being, where we are in our studies, I just remember IP, index of protection or international protection. Top surface is IP4X, objects exceeding 1 mil cannot enter. The sides, bottom and front are IP2X. In order we apply to ADS, all the circuits within the installation must also automatically disconnect in the event of a fault. So when we open up our consumer's unit, we can see we've got individual overcurrent protection devices, in this case in the form of circuit breakers. The main switch here is a linked main switch or double pole switch, which will simultaneously turn off both live conductors. When we operate the main switch, it will turn off both line and neutral simultaneously at the same time to isolate the distribution board. Our individual overcurrent protection devices go off to feed cooker, sockets, lights and that in the installation and need to be sized correctly. Often the lighting circuit is fused at 6 amps, a ring final circuit at 32, a cooker circuit at 32. These overcurrent protection devices also have maximum disconnection times in the event of a fault. The rule currently is circuits up to and including 32 amps must disconnect within 0.4 of a second. Circuits over 32 amps have a maximum disconnection time of 5 seconds. So we've looked at the earthing conductor and protective bonding conductor. We've also got to remember part of the earth family for ADS will be the individual circuit protective conductors, CPCs, that will go around the circuit to each individual accessory. So they've got the CPCs in place as well. So in the event that there's been a fault in circuit, potentially the CPC could become live and obviously disconnect the circuit. And we expect all disconnection times to fall within either 0.4 or 5 seconds, depending on the size of the actual device itself. As we look at our lighting circuit, we can see that our switches, and in this case, battery lamp holders are all insulated, so they're all plastic. So in this case, the CPC is actually connected within there, but actually not serving any purpose at the moment. So we've got a CPC connecting in here, but it's not serving any purpose. However, this can be changed, or the switch can be changed for a metallic one. That is an exposed conductive part. All exposed conductive parts need connecting to the CPC. In the event of an exposed conductive part becoming live, we expect the circuit to automatically disconnect in order to reduce the risk of three things stated earlier: shock, fire, and explosions. So there is a CPC inside the switch, there's a CPC inside my battery lamp holder. They're waiting for the fact that it could be changed for an exposed conductive part. The socket outlet on this part of the circuit is metallic, so they are exposed conductive parts. So as well as being terminated into the actual termination in the socket outlet back, so the pin here at the front can be an earth pin, that also is earthing the back box and front plate because these are exposed conductive parts. In the event of this socket outlet coming live, it would be unreasonable for somebody to walk up and touch it and receive an electric shock. We expect the circuit to automatically disconnect before that happens. Under ADS, it would. So in the event of this exposed conductive part becoming live, it would automatically disconnect the overcurrent protection device within the consumer unit within the specified time. For a socket circuit, it's on a ring final circuit fuse at 32 amps. It will disconnect within a maximum of 0.4 seconds in order to reduce the risk of three things: shock, fire, and explosions. So with ADS in place, in other words, we've got the appropriate size fuse coming in at the incoming point and the appropriate size fuses within the consumer's unit. We've got our earthing conductor in place and sized correctly, our protective bonding conductors if required off to our gas, water, or oil, etc. And we've got our circuit protective conductor coming round. ADS is in place, but we can additionally protect the circuits, and that's commonplace now in domestic dwellings, is that additional protection will be offered by an RCD, a residual current device, rated at 30 milliamps or less. That we have an RCD here and an RCD here, and that's a split board. So this RCD here rated at 30 milliamps protects a number of circuits going this way, and this RCD here protects a number of circuits going that way. So they have additional protection. The RCD rated at 30 milliamps offers additional protection. Additional protection is required for socket outlets, which is a 13 amp socket outlets, and currently in the regulations it says socket outlets up to 32 amps. It isn't the rated value of the breaker. This ring final circuit may be rated at 32 amps. It's the rated value of the socket outlet itself. These are 13 amp socket outlets. All socket outlets in the domestic dwelling are going to require additional protection by an RCD rated at 30 milliamps. Other additional protection will be required where cables are running stud walls. So again, if you've got lighting circuits, cooker circuits, etc., all running stud walls with no further protection, additional protection would be required. If you're not burying cables in the wall at a depth of 50 mil or greater, those circuits will need additional protection. You can get round additional protection by an RCD by installing cable systems in a domestic dwelling, such as steel wire armoured, mineral insulated. In other words, a wiring system with a metallic earth sheath would need to be wired like that, rather than putting an additional protection via an RCD. Industry has deemed it's easier to additionally protect circuits in a domestic dwelling by an RCD rate of 30 milliamps or less, rather than try and get around that. In some instances, we can't get around it. Socket outlets, we can't. They have to be additionally protected by an RCD because the socket outlet can be plugged inside and the lead taken outside. So therefore, all socket outlets need additional protection by an RCD. Also, all circuits in a bathroom need additionally protected by an RCD rated at 30 milliamps or less. Doesn't leave many circuits left in a house where we would, for instance, wire it in steel wire armoured to prevent additional protection, or bury those cables 50 mil or greater in a wall. The reason being, we don't want someone to inadvertently screw into, nail into cables that are buried in the wall, creating a fault. So to overcome that, we either have to have an earth metal sheath, such as a steel wire armoured or an MI cable would provide, bury it at 50 mil deep, so we believe that they wouldn't be damaged inadvertently by somebody hanging a picture on the wall and hammering a nail in. Industry doesn't go down that route. Industry goes down the route domestically of additional protection for all circuits offered by an RCD rated at 30 milliamps or below. So in order to comply to ADS, we need the appropriate conductors from earthing conductor, protective bonding conductor, and the CPCs around the circuit to be in place. We need the appropriate overcurrent protection device for each circuit. So in other words, the fuse to be rated correctly. We may offer additional protection for circuits, which is very commonplace in domestic dwellings. Additional protection is offered by an RCD rated at 30 milliamps or below. We wouldn't want all circuits to disconnect at the same time. So we either put several RCCBs in or we use RCBOs, and we'll discuss that in a later presentation. We know that exposed conductive parts, such as metal clad sockets, metallic light fittings, metallic switches, need to be connected to the circuit protective conductor. So in the event of them becoming live, that they disconnect the circuit within the maximum times of either 0.4 or 5 seconds. We've also got metallic water and gas pipes here, which are extraneous conductive parts. And again, in the event of one of these becoming live, we need to make sure the circuit disconnects. We do not want the voltage between bonded parts to rise above 50. Again, we're trying to reduce the risk of three things, being shock, fire, and explosions. We've also added in the fact that the IP rating the top of any electrical enclosure must be IP4X. Objects exceeding 1 millimeter cannot enter. In other words, dust, really, primarily. And the rest, being the side, the bottom, and the other side and front, must have an IP rating of at least IP2X. In real terms, we cannot stick our index finger into those electrical enclosures. We look to have active selectivity between our devices. 100 amp incoming fuse for me here. The rule of thumb is that if we move further downstream, that we have devices with a ratio of roughly 2-to-1. So if we've got a 100 amp fuse here in this installation, the largest fuse in here is 32 amps or 40 amps perhaps. Circuit breaker feeding another circuit, so you automatically got a ratio of 2-to-1. Moving forward, that's what we're going to be looking at in the set of notes on fuses as well. We'll look at the selectivity between devices, but a good rule of thumb is 2-to-1. So as we move through, so if you think the 32-amp ring final circuit fuse feeds a 13-amp socket, the largest fuse inside a plug top is 13 amps. Again, you've achieved that 2-to-1 or greater than ratio as a rule of thumb between fuses. So in the event of plugging something in with a fault, it should disconnect the plug top fuse and not disconnect the whole circuit by disconnecting the circuit breaker. Unless it's an earth fault, then there's a good chance the RCD would have operated in that case. So that's a little whistle-top tour of ADS, and we've introduced IP ratings, we've introduced extraneous conductive parts being non-electrical and metal, such as the water pipe, the gas pipe, and the oil pipe. We've introduced exposed conductive parts, metallic, electrical, so a motor would be an exposed conductive part, the oven would be an exposed conductive part, metal-clad socket, metal light fitting would be exposed conductive parts. I hope this one's been some help.